So in the previous sections, we've defined placebo, we've talked about the psychological antecedents to it, and we've discussed the neural mechanisms. I think we have a pretty good feeling for how the expectation of relief can actually cause relief, a self-fulfilling expectation, if you will. It's a question of mind over matter. However, there are some questions that are raised by what we found out about the placebo. One of the first things that comes to mind, and this is something with real important clinical implications, if the expectation of relief can actually cause relief of pain, is it possible that the expectation of a worsening of pain or an expectation of no effect of a drug can actually impair the ability of a drug to produce relief? I think the answer to that is pretty clearly yes. And let's talk a little bit about that now. This is what would be called the nocebo, the opposite of placebo. So here's a clinical study of patients with low back pain who are being treated with a long-acting morphine preparation. They were taken off their drug for the first 3 weeks. Okay, this is a pain scale here, and it correlates. Up is better, which means more relief. Down is worse. One means very little relief. And they were taken off their opioid and then retitrated. So this was the drug used, MS Contin, a long-acting morphine, 60 milligrams. They were titrated up to this dose, and you could see that as drug was added, they got more and more relief. That's good. The open circles here are placebo. Same thing. They titrated up, gave more and more placebos, and they got more and more relief. And then they were maintained on a given dose of either morphine or placebo for 6 weeks. And then they were taken off their drug, and it was washed out. They were retitrated. The group that had gotten placebo then got morphine. The group that got morphine then got placebo. You can see there looks to be a mild tolerance effect for the morphine. Placebo remains very ineffective, hardly any different level of pain than before they started. They washed out, and then they were switched over to the opposite drug. The main thing I want you to look at is the placebo group. That's shown here. Okay, they're washed out, and now they're started in on morphine at this point, right? And the morphine, after they've received placebo, is ineffective. So morphine after placebo, no effect. Morphine before placebo, quite effective. So clearly what's happened is, in the course of receiving placebo, there's been a conditioning effect so that now the expectation of relief is markedly reduced. And even though they've gotten an effective drug after 6 weeks of being on no drug, they shouldn't be tolerant at all. Tolerance and dependence should have worn off. In fact, they don't see any effect of the morphine. So that's the nocebo effect. And that's a very important clinical phenomenon you need to be aware of. Let's summarize what we've talked about in the previous sections. These are the important clinical implications. First, severe pains respond to analgesics, to placebos, right? The fact that somebody's pain has responded to a sugar pill doesn't mean they didn't have pain, and it doesn't mean it's not severe, right? So you can't say anything about whether or not somebody has severe pain by whether or not they respond to a placebo. So just forget about that. We learn that expectation and conditioning, what the drugs that they've received and what they're told, has a major role in the level of relief that they expect. So it's going to be very important to keep that in mind. Finally, we've learned something quite remarkable, and that is that endogenous opioids are released when patients expect pain relief. And those endogenous opioids produce pain relief that you can block with an antagonist that's selective to the mu opioid receptor. Finally, and very importantly, expectation can either enhance or worsen pain. So what are the implications of what we've learned? First is, when you're in a treatment situation with a patient, it's very important what you say and how you say it. You could take a new medication and you could tell the patient, well, this is something I think we ought to try. I'm not sure that it's going to work. We don't have a complete set of experiments to prove that it works, but I think we should give it a try. That's one thing you could say. Another thing you could say is, I'm going to try you on a drug, and I've had very good results with some of my patients who had a condition very similar to yours. You can see that the tone and the message are quite different in those two statements. And I think it's very important for you to decide what kind of message you want to convey when you're starting a treatment. The other thing that's really important is to find out before you start a treatment what the patient's expectations are for what you're going to do. If they say, look, doc, you know, I've tried everything. I really don't think you're going to help me. Then you need to explore with the patient why they feel that way. If it's unrealistically negative, you could actually help them by explaining to them that there really is a better chance that they'll improve than they think. So that's important. Let's talk a little bit about the ethics. Clearly, the traditional use of a placebo to try to diagnose a patient's faking isn't going to work. You're going to make more wrong diagnoses than correct diagnoses. And furthermore, if a patient gets better after a sugar pill, you don't know that they got better because they got the sugar pill. It could have been regression to the mean, and it could have been the natural history. So just forget about that. Exploit the value of optimism. Be as honest as you can in a way that's not harmful to the patient. Because in the end, if the patient doesn't trust you and they don't believe what you say, you can be as optimistic as you want and it's not going to help. Finally, one intriguing philosophical question that I think would be useful for you to ponder would be, now that we know what the important psychological factors are leading to enhanced expectation of relief, now that we know the neural mechanisms, both at the circuit level and at the pharmacological level, about how this expectation works to produce relief, can you actually say that what we're doing when we induce the expectation of relief is a placebo? It seems to me that it's a known effective treatment with a physical, well-known mechanism that's been well-established. I would submit to you that that's as good as you can do, and I don't think it's helpful to call it a placebo. And I'd like to end with that.